So why we need IT for SMEs? So there are for obvious reasons. They need to reach a wider audience. So they can get going with the manual stuff they do and the traditional stuff. But to reach a wider audience, they pretty soon they get the requirement of going with IT, and they want to improve the user experience, because especially with the millennials now starting to use these systems, like the expectations are pretty high. So user experience has to be very good. So for example, they need to have access through mobile apps, websites, and all those things, and even the sites they have to load pretty quickly, and all those requirements. And most importantly, with the high competition and the lesser margin of the profit, so they have to reduce operational costs, and so all those requirements are there. So the challenges when moving to IT is, so there are a couple of challenges. So especially you have the liability of maintaining an IT staff. And also the quality of work depends on the expertise of your IT staff. And then you have developed solutions either from scratch or at beginning from some level. And after you develop, you have to host them. So hosting becomes a problem, because there is infrastructure cost. You have to maintain them. They have to be up and running all the time. So then you need to have additional staff. So all those problems comes. And then there are huge license fees, where it becomes difficult for you to bear those license fees. And with the fast-moving world, time to market becomes very important. So you need to develop your solutions quickly and market quickly. And then to improve your business and solutions and the way you reach the end users, so you need to have analytics as well. So I'll be telling a story. I call it John's story, where John was able to improve his expand his business and be a successful man. So John runs a taxi service, and he wants to expand his business. So he was looking for solutions, and someone advises him to launch a website. To allow people to book rides through the website, because like at that time he was running it all through the phones. So John hires a web developer called Bill, and this is where the story starts. So Bill develops a web app which allows the users to book rides, and he tests it locally, and now he's looking for a place to host. But being the John's taxi service being a very small business, and he didn't have an IT staff until then, so they don't have any idea about hosting these and having data centers, all those things. So the requirements in hosting are, first thing is like your app needs to be available at least for the critical times, and it should be handle the load. Although it might not get high load, it should be handled the load. And it should provide acceptable performance, because you can't click a button and wait a couple of minutes for the results to appear. And most of these applications, they need a database to process data. And it would be nice to have a nice URL rather than a very lengthy, ugly URL. So Bill has at this time convinced John to buy this domain called johnscaps.com. So now Bill comes to hear about WSO2Cloud, where it has an App Cloud and API Cloud, which is already available. And so he comes to know about it, and then he goes and explores. So the image in his talk, he mentioned that WSO2Cloud is the public cloud offering from WSO2, and the App Cloud allows you to host applications, and API Cloud is the API manager product as a service. So in App Cloud, you can host Java web applications, Java microservices based on MSF4j. Then you can host PHP web applications and also the jQuery application. So let me get out from the story and explain certain things. So why we have allowed jQuery application is, so jQuery apps are not much used in the outside world, but it's heavily used in WSO2 for their internal applications. So WSO2 has hosted their internal apps also in WSO2 Cloud, so therefore we have to support the jQuery application type as well. And we are planning to support Node, the popular app types like Node.js and stuff. So these are some of the screenshots. So the one in the left-hand side is app which you have hosted, not the app, but the dashboard of the app. And these are the available app types. And also, it allows you to view the logs. So I'll tell how it happens. So these are the features of App Cloud. So this runs on Kubernetes, where you get a Docker container per each app version. So when you upload your application, App Cloud starts a Docker container, and that's where your app gets deployed. So you have total isolation for your app. So there was a previous version of App Cloud as well, but it was using a shared runtime, and we had some limitations in that one. So we had to enable the security manager stuff to allow each tenant's apps are not getting affected. But with the container approach, we don't have to worry about that. We have an isolated container for each app. And this has the horizontal scalability. And also, it allows you to select from different container sizes. For example, depending on your application, you can select whether it should have 512 MB of RAM or 1 gig of RAM or 2 gig of RAM. And also the CPU processing power as well. And it allows you to configure a custom URL for your app, so which is that is pretty much available with all the app clouds as well, and also allows database provisioning as well. Because like we have realized that when a person comes with an app, he most probably has a requirement having an app, a database as well for the use of that app. So now getting back to the story, Bill was able to host that application which he developed in the App Cloud, and now it's publicly available. Now, John is a very ambitious guy, so he wants a mobile app to reach more wider audience. And he also, now he asked Bill to develop this app, mobile app, and he wants to see some analytics on which app is being used more. So now Bill has more work to do, but he's a smart guy. So Bill has developed his application with back end front end separation. So he was able to extract the backend and deploy it as a separate application in the App Cloud. So now the App Cloud has two applications. One is the front-end application, and the other one is the back-end application. Now this backend, he wants to make it a managed API because he wants to access it using the web app and also the mobile app. So he wants a managed API. Then he comes to know about the API Cloud. So he has heard about API Cloud, and he has also seen the API Cloud when he went to deploy the App Cloud. So he goes and accesses the API Cloud. So this is a screenshot of the API Cloud UI, where you have three APIs published in a tenant. So when Bill goes to the API Cloud, the first experience he gets an interactive tutorial. So within 5 minutes, Bill has a sample API deployed and published in the API Cloud. So by following the interactive tutorial, he is able to publish his first API within a few minutes. So then Bill starts referring the documentation. So there are both step-by-step documentations and the screencast where he can easily follow and get things done. So for the different scenarios which are supported by the API Cloud, there are the videos and docs. So Bill creates the API, and he creates two virtual applications, one for his the web app and one for the mobile app. And he subscribes these applications to the API. And then he generates tokens, because in the API Cloud, we authorize using the auth tokens. So he gets a true set of tokens, and now he invokes his API through the API console. So this is a screenshot of the API console. So this is the API, and you can see the results when he gets after he invokes the API using the API console. So after this is done, so he goes and changes the web app and the mobile app to invoke this API. So earlier, the web app was using the backend service, and the mobile app was not developed. But now he has changed the web app and mobile app to invoke the managed API. So while doing this, he had to get some support, because like since he was new to API management and he was not much familiar with the WSO2 API manager, he had to get some support. So the primary support was the documentation, but whenever the docs were not enough, so he was able to get support from the cloud team through the direct emails, by sending support requests, and also there is an interactive chat which he can get real-time support from the staff. So then, Bill was happy with the APIs he created and the API management solution. But he was doing all this with a trial account. So the trial was going to expire, and he was able to get extension by requesting for an extension. And he was able to do the final set of testing. And now he was thinking that he should become a paid user of the API Cloud. The prices they start with $100 per month. That's the lowest tier. And so there are higher tiers as well for $250, $750, and $3,000, and so on and so forth, with different limitations. For example, the API volume, number of users, those kind of things. So Bill pays with John's credit card and upgrades that tenant to a paid account. So this is the available plans. We have the starter plan, get interaction, medium, large, extra large. So we have the calls per day, accounts, and the additional overage charges as well. So finally, Bill was able to host the application and mobile app and API, everything. And these are some of the statistics. So John wanted some stats, and these are some of the stats they get from the API manager, API Cloud. So now John wants to expand his audience. So he has reached the web audience and mobile audience. Now he wants the travel sites, like hotels and all those things, to book rides using book rides with his cab service or the taxi service. So he wants to advertise his API for the others to use. So when doing so, he wants to do some customizations as well. So one is like he doesn't want the API, the URL of the API store. So the API Cloud provides API store, but he doesn't want it to be branded with the WSO2 stuff. He wants it to be branded with his themes and URLs and all those things. So since he has bought the jonescaps.com domain, he's able to provide a custom URL for his API store and his APIs as well. And Bill designs a theme which matches with the jonescaps.com site, and he was able to customize the API store theme to match that one. So this is a API store with a custom theme. Now, so John's expectation was that the third parties to use his API. So he has advertised his API in the store. Now the third parties, they come, they explore the APIs, and now they want to subscribe to those APIs and use them. So one thing is, they want to sign up. They want to sign up to the organization because they need to be authenticated before subscribing and invoking, generating tokens. So there's a feature called self-sign-up, so they can send a sign-up request and sign up. But the good thing is there is the approval process as well. So Bill or John, whenever there is a self-sign-up request, Bill or John, they go through it and they approve it. So they have the control on who's going to subscribe to their APIs. Now, since this API was evolving, so Bill had to create different versions. So he had to create several versions. So he was keeping one as the production version, and he was working on another. Then he was also creating multiple versions of the application and the backend application, and he was pointing these different applications to different versions of the backend. So both App Cloud and API Cloud allows that. So App Cloud allows you to host multiple versions of your application, but and keep one version as a default one. Also, the API Cloud also allows the same. So you can create multiple versions of the APIs and mark one as the default one. So it gives you that flexibility. So John is happy now because like his business is growing. So he has been able to reach wider audience. And it only cost him a very little amount of money. That is, he had to only pay Bill's salary and only $100 per month for the API Cloud subscription. And App Cloud, since App Cloud was still in beta, it was free use for him. So his application is running there, but it's totally free. So Bill is also happy because like he doesn't need to do any maintenance. So the high availability and 99% nine time of uptime. So everything is guaranteed by the cloud, and he got rewarded for his work as well. So that's how they used the App Cloud and API Cloud. Now, so what's next is like as Image and I think some other guys mentioned in their talks, the coming up next is the Integration Cloud. So Integration Cloud, at the beginning, we are planning to support this cloud-to-cloud integration stuff. For example, so this screenshot shows you an example where we gets records, we query records from Salesforce, and we send a send an email using the Gmail. So that everything, this integration solution, this cloud-to-cloud integration solution, is developed using the Developer Studio. So the tooling is provided by the Developer Studio. So you have to develop the solution and bring the export the car file and come and upload in the Integration Cloud. And then you can set some parameters and schedule your integration scenario. For example, if you want this syncing, let's say you want to sync your data in Salesforce to a spreadsheet, and if you want it to happen only once a day, so you can set the period as one, the time period as once per day, and you can schedule it and it will run every day. So you can test, and so in this one it's not appearing, so you have the logs and everything. So this is very close of being released as alpha version in the cloud, which will be available in a couple of weeks. So at the moment, we have it in our staging environment, and we are doing some tests and some fine-tuning on the scenarios. So the idea is to provide all the ESB as a service features. For example, you will be in the near future, you will be able to host a proxy service which connects to one of your backends and do some transformation using the Integration Cloud. And Identity Cloud is also coming soon. So to begin with, we'll be supporting the SSO scenario. So for example, if you have one of your applications and you want to configure a single sign-on with that one, so you will be able to do that with the Identity Cloud. So so that's about how to get started with the App Cloud and API Cloud. So I'll tell something more. So now API Cloud is a commercial commercially available. So people, they come and sign up, they create tenants, and they upgrade to paid accounts and they start using. Now so we one scenario we have seen is these partners and system integrators, so who develop solutions for these SMEs or these small businesses. So they come and they create a tenant for that customer of theirs, and so they do this. They expose their data as API, and they do some integration, and that tenant only costs them about $100 per month, depending on their traffic. But the SIO, the partner, they can earn a huge amount of money. For example, I don't know the project cost, but let's say you cost $10,000. So it only costs $200 for the hosting of all the work per month. So you have $9,900 of profit. So like that, there's the huge potential for SMEs and SIs to make good use of the cloud. And the other thing is, like, if you expose, and I forgot to mention here, if you expose your APIs, and the people who expose the APIs, they can monetize the APIs as well, which means, like, so for example, in John's case, John exposes his API, and third parties subscribe to it, and now he can charge the third parties for using his APIs. So that feature is also available since a couple of months ago. Right, so that's it about the App Cloud and API Cloud. So I encourage you to go sign up and try it, because especially if you are thinking of some API management solutions, you will be able to try the API Cloud very easily, and also you can host your applications in App Cloud.